The fourth great mark of the church is apostolicity. We say the church is apostolic. It means something very simple. It means it's rooted in the apostles. Those 12 men whom Jesus personally chose, shaped and formed according to his own mind. Remember that great scene, the beginning of John's gospel? Two of John the Baptist's disciples come to Jesus. He turns on them. He says, "What do you seek?" They say, "Lord, where do you stay?" He said, "Come and see." And then they stayed with him. That's a model of the apostolic life. These people who stayed with Jesus, in close quarters with him, they were formed and shaped by his mind. It's upon those figures that Christianity rests. Again, the church is not a philosophical debating society. It's grounded in this person, Jesus, whom these apostles knew. That's why in the early church, apostolic pedigree was so important. They could trace their faith back to an apostle who preached to them. That's why the city of Rome became so paramount in the early church, because not one, but two of the great apostles, Peter and Paul, lived here, taught here, died here. I'm standing in this magnificent basilica of St. John Lateran in Rome. Behind me, you can see over the main altar are reliquaries that hold, tradition says, the heads of Peter and Paul, the two great apostles. And then surrounding me, they form the ribs and the structure of the church itself, are depictions of the 12 apostles. You can't see it anywhere better in the world than here, the apostolic nature of the church. We can see, too, why apostolic succession was so important. The apostles at one point passed on their authority to those whom they had trained, who they knew had the apostolic faith. Then those successors in turn passed it on to others again, even down to the present day, so that bishops today can claim that they are the successors of the apostles. Every priest in the Catholic Church is ordained by a bishop. Whatever power or authority I have as a priest comes to me from the fact that I was ordained by a bishop. That means that the whole leadership of the church is apostolic in structure. The word hierarchy comes to mind. We speak of the hierarchical church. Don't think of it primarily in terms of power. Think of it in terms of this etymology. Hierarchy comes from two Greek words, hieros and arche. Hieros means priest, arche means rule or principle. The hierarchical church is one that's ruled by priests. Again, don't think of it as a power game. Think of it as a church ruled, governed, grounded in this apostolic faith. A last thought. The word apostle comes from the Greek word apostelein. It means to send. Jesus took these 12 people whom he had formed after his own heart, and then he sent them. The Christian faith is never meant to be held onto as a private privilege. It's meant to be shared, to be spread like seed around the world. And so the apostolic church to the present day still has that great missionary purpose. Again, this quality of the church is countercultural, at least in the West. We favor democracy, the free play of ideas, freedom of expression, the power to vote leaders in and out. Aren't these values out of step with a church hierarchically arranged? As I indicated, the church is not a philosophical debating society, nor a democratic polity, but rather a body grounded in revelation. There is accordingly a structure and a content that are simply given and have to be maintained in the course of the centuries. Here, the hierarchy of the church is not unlike the Supreme Court in our political system, since it maintains the fundamental structure without which the body would collapse. The church would not be itself were it to deny the divinity of Jesus, the facticity of the resurrection, the existence of the triune God, the activity of the Holy Spirit, etc. And mind you, all of these things have been denied by figures up and down the centuries.
were these matters able to be adjudicated through a vote of the faithful or of theologians, the church would lose its integrity. This brings us to what is perhaps the most controversial and misunderstood dimension of the church's apostolicity, namely the charism of infallibility enjoyed by the Pope, the successor of the Prince of the Apostles. It would be helpful, I think, first to state as clearly as possible what papal infallibility is not. It does not mean that the Pope is omniscient. It does not mean he can predict the future. It does not mean that he's immune from making bad practical judgments. And it certainly doesn't mean that he's above criticism or incapable of sin. In fact, some of the saints were sharp critics of popes, and Dante places some wicked popes in the lower circles of hell. So what does it mean to say the Pope is infallible? It means that he knows who Jesus is. And therefore, when, summoning his full authority, he articulates those doctrines and moral precepts that flow from that knowledge, he is prevented from making a mistake. Now, I know it's difficult for us, especially in the West, to accept this doctrine. We believe in the free play of ideas. We're naturally suspicious of claims to authority, especially infallible authority. Maybe John Henry Newman can help us a little bit. Newman said this: if it pleased God to reveal something to the church, it should also please God to give us a living voice of authority that would interpret that revelation down through the ages. In Newman's time, many Protestants said, well, the Bible, that's the source of authority. But Newman knew the Bible is subject to a wide variety of interpretations. The young Newman himself said, the consensus of the church fathers, that's the source of authority. But it dawned on Newman as he grew older that the fathers were not a living voice, no matter how wise and insightful they were. It was only the Church of Rome that claimed that the Pope, in communion with the bishops, was a living voice of authority. If I might apply Newman's comparison a bit, anyone that loves baseball knows that the umpires are indispensable to the flow of the game. Without an umpire, a baseball game would devolve in very short order into bickering over calls. Is he safe? Is he out? Was that fair? Was it foul? The umpire, who is present to the game and is a living voice of authority and can make a decisive decision, he allows the flow of the game to go on. So, the infallible Pope is not there to shut down the play of the church's life. That means the church's teaching, its care for the poor, its proclamation of the good news, its liturgy, its art, all of that. The Pope is not there to shut that down. But rather, he's there as a living voice of authority to allow that play to continue, lest it devolve into bickering. Perhaps just a word about the keys. Jesus said to Peter, I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. G.K. Chesterton saw something. He said a key would be useless if it changed shape, if it's changed form. It's the very hardness of the key that makes it effective in opening locks. What was given to the church was a key to unlock the secret to life, the secret to the great mystery of all things. Well, if that key was flexible, if that key was changeable, it would lose its whole reason for being. And so it's upon this rock of Peter's authority, the one who holds the keys, that the church is indeed built. So the church is apostolic. It's formed by the faith of these 12 apostles of Jesus. Well, then here's an objection. How come the church seems to change so much over the centuries? How come even today, in many of its external forms and practices and customs, the church seems so different than in apostolic times? If Peter or Paul walked into this great basilica, would they feel completely at home? Well, probably not. How do we explain the changes within the church? John Henry Newman, to me, is very helpful here. He talks about the development of doctrine. Newman says, look, ideas exist, not on the printed page. Ideas exist in the play of lively minds. If I take in an idea,
I analyze it, I judge it, I compare it, I contrast it, I turn it around. I then throw it to somebody else. They do the same thing, they toss it back to me. It's in this lively play that the full panoply of the idea unfolds. Newman said, a real idea is equivalent to the sum total of its possible aspects. Only when I've seen all the different angles and profiles of an idea do I really understand it. Think of it in terms of a physical object, like St. Peter's Basilica. Now, I've seen St. Peter's up close. It looks a certain way. I've seen it from all the way across the city of Rome. I've seen it even from an airplane. I've seen it from the Janiculum Hill. In each perspective, it looks different. A different aspect appears. Now consider the doctrine of the church. An idea as complex as the incarnation or creation or the Trinity. That idea can be taken in by the church only over time as the idea unfolds. That's why Newman says the apostolic faith is not passed on like a dumb object, like passing a football from one to another. Rather, it unfolds like a river that deepens and broadens in time. It grows like a great tree that might begin as an acorn, but then it develops as this mighty oak tree. That's why we see change in the life of the church, not as though the essential apostolic faith has been betrayed, but rather it's growing, unfolding. We are, yes, an apostolic church, but we are also a living church.
Just before boarding the train that would carry him to Rome in the conclave that would elect him Pope John XXIII, Cardinal Angelo Giuseppe Roncalli commented, in regard to himself and his fellow cardinals, "We are not here to guard a museum, but to cultivate a flourishing garden of life." The Church of Jesus Christ is not a collection of cultural objets d'art, not a stuffy institutional holdover from another age. It is rather, as the mosaic at San Clemente suggests, a living thing, an organism, a body. Its head is Jesus himself, and its lifeblood is the Holy Spirit. Its purpose is to be a conduit of the divine life to the world, a light to the nations, a new Eden.